But let's get to the sermon this morning. If you're out in your automobile, turn in your Bible to Mark chapter 4. We're going to look at six or seven verses, verses 35 through 41. We're going to look at those about, this is the time when Jesus wakes from the boat and there's a storm out at the sea. And the apostles, they're in the boat with him, said, "Master, carest thou not that we perish?" Jesus rebukes the winds and the waves. He says, "Peace, be still." And a great calm is suddenly upon that sea. And they ask, "What manner of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey his voice?" Now, Mark's not the only one that tells us this story. We read about it in Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 through 27. And we read about it in Luke chapter 8, verses 22 through 25. But we're going to be focusing in on what Mark said about this in this sermon this morning, because we're kind of working ourselves through the book of Mark. So Mark chapter 4 and verse 35. What manner of man is this? That's what Mark has been trying to tell us. That's why Mark has written this book we have called the Book of Mark. He wants people to know what manner of man Jesus is. And the question is raised and answered throughout Mark's book. We've already seen it. Jesus cast a demon out of a man. It tore the man and violently left that man. And Jesus cast that demon away, and they were right there in the synagogue. And they were all amazed, Mark 1:27. Inasmuch as they questioned among themselves, saying, "What thing is this? What new doctrine is this? But with authority, he commandeth the unclean spirits, and they do depart from him." And then they brought a man to Jesus who was bedridden. And they let him down through the roof to Jesus, and he saw the man. And he said, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." Well, the scribes and the Pharisees that were there, they didn't like that. He said, "Son, thy sins be forgiven thee." There was certain, this is Mark 2, 5 through 7. There were certain of the scribes sitting there reasoning in their hearts, "What doth this man thus speak blasphemies?" Or why does this man speak blasphemies? "Who can forgive sins but God only?" I tell you what, then Jesus told the man to rise up and walk, and he did. And when he did, it said, Mark 2, 6 and 7, they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw it on this fashion. What manner of man is this that can do these things? Cast out spirits, forgive men of their sins." And then Mark 4 and verse 41, in the story we'll look at today, "What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" Okay, let's look at this. Mark 4:35. "And the same day, when even was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over to the other side." That same day, if you go back and read in Mark, you'll see what happened that day. And look at the other accounts to fill in the gaps. Jesus had spent that previous night, he had been up all night in prayer out on the mountain alone. And then he called unto him those 12 who was his chosen. He'd been praying about who to choose, and he called those 12 that would be his apostles. He returned to Capernaum, and the people pressed around him. It says they pressed around him so much that they could not even eat bread. They couldn't even eat. There were so many there. His mother and his brothers came to him, and they couldn't get to him. They sent someone in through that crowd, but they couldn't get to him. They pressed on him so much. And in the midst of all of this, Jesus is accused of working with the devil. He commands spirits to go out by the power of Beelzebub, they said. And Jesus had to deal with that and answer that criticism. And then he left and he went down to the seashore, and the great multitude followed him out of that town down to the seashore. And so he tells those apostles, let me just get in the boat. And so he got in the boat where they could see him on three sides, if that's the little bay we think it was. And he stood in that boat, like that little fishing boat. They call it a ship, but it's a little fishing boat there. And from that fishing boat, he uses that as his pulpit to teach those parables and explain the kingdom of heaven. And now evening was come, and he is weary. And so he says, let's go to the other side. He needs to get away. And the best way, the most convenient way, just go by sea. We'll just take this boat and cross the sea. And so they took him even as he was, it says in verse 36. That sounds like he said, let's go. He said, well, let's go. They just took him like he was. He didn't get to go home, take a shower, or change his clothes, or we don't even know if he had a decent meal, and he didn't get to take a nap. They just took him like he was. And so he is weary. He is worn out at the end of this day. And it says there were also with him other little ships. Now, Mark's the only one that tells us about these other little ships, but that's interesting, isn't it? Jesus is getting away from that multitude, and as he sets out across that sea, as many as can, they find other little ships, and they're going with him. They're just going to follow him. And so you see Jesus headed out across that sea, and his 12 in that boat, and then all these other little ships are going out there. Now, listen, they wouldn't know exactly what went on in that boat where Jesus was, but they would have been in that storm too. They can later come back and tell. You wouldn't believe the storm we got into when we went out there. But it just, all of a sudden, it was over. They would be witnesses of what would have occurred as Jesus went out across that sea in those other little ships. Here's a picture of a little ship. Let me refer to my notes here because I don't remember all the details. Now, what I'm showing here up on the screen is a picture of a hull of a fishing boat that they found in the Sea of Galilee. Now, they found this little hull, and the year was 1986. It's on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee. That's where Jesus was. They found it buried in the mud, and they dated it. And it dates back to the first century. This could have been one of those little ships. If it wasn't, it was one like it. As they took the measures on this boat and all, you just see the hull of it there. It is 27 feet long and 7 feet wide, and it's large enough for 15 men. The stern, now the stern, that's the rear of it. Is it? Well, it would be elevated. Now, there's a little model below this picture that I'm showing, a little model of one of those fishing boats. And it's not just a little John boat, it's bigger than that. Now, I don't know if he'd call it a ship, but it is a larger boat. And so you can see the stern, you see the boards, and they say, now this is the kind of fishing boats that they had. And so by seeing that, it kind of helps you to picture. Look at the back of that boat. And those boards across the back, that would have been the stern. And it had been in that part of the boat where Jesus was in this. So they're out there on the Sea of Galilee. And it says, there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. That's Mark chapter 4 and verse 37. Go back, look at that little model. You see how the boat can be full down in the boat, but up there on the stern, you still wouldn't be in the water up there on the stern. You see how that's a little elevated there. So that's how all that story kind of fits together. The Sea of Galilee, 13 miles long, 7 miles wide, 150 feet deep, and 700 feet below sea level. And the hills around them would be like mountains if you're already 700 feet down looking up. And they say that even to this day, storms, winds can just suddenly come rolling off those mountains across and hit that sea. Now again, I'm going to refer to my notes here to find this, but it was in 1992. The winds came down on the sea from the Golan Heights and whipped up waves 10 feet high. That's something for an inland sea, isn't it? Well, that's the kind of storm that they head out. It doesn't look that stormy, but things can change fast on that sea. And so there's this great storm of wind and the waves beating on that boat and filling up the hull. And where's Jesus? He's in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. Now there's a lot of commentators trying to tell us what this pillow is. I bet it wasn't a feather pillow, you know, or what's this guy selling pillows today? What's his name? You know, the new pillow or something. Wasn't like that. Could have been just something rolled up for his head. Some say, no, it's part of the ship. You could have put your head on or something. But anyway, his head's over here, does mention on a pillow, and he's asleep. Okay, take a good look in your mind at that weary man asleep in that boat. And there's a storm raging around him. And he is so exhausted. He just slept. Have you ever slept through a storm? Have you ever woke up and said, what about that storm last night? I said, was it storm last night? You just slept all the way through it. Terrible storm. And you slept through it. You were exhausted. And Jesus here sleeping through that storm. And now here's what I want to ask you about that weary man asleep in that boat with his head on a pillow and a storm raging around and that ship being threatened by the water that had entered it. And I want to ask you, does that look like God to you? Does it look like God to you asleep? Didn't the Elijah ridicule the prophets of Baal when he says, call louder, maybe your God's on a trip, maybe he's asleep? Does that look like God? We read in Psalm 121 and verse 4. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. Look at that man. You see, when you see Jesus asleep on that boat in that storm, you're looking at him in his humiliation. You're looking at him in his humanity. He thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but took upon himself the form of a man and was made like unto us. And he wore himself out. And he was weary. And he was hungry. And he was thirsty. Now he's asleep. They awake him and say to him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Sounds like they panicked to me. And when you think about it, these are fishermen. Now, these people know the Sea of Galilee, but evidently this storm had gotten where they were scared now. Master, carest thou not that we perish? It's told different ways in different accounts, and I bet they were all yelling different things here. Look at Jesus. Wake him up. They're saying, Lord, save us, we perish in Matthew. Master, carest thou not that we perish in Mark? Luke says, Master, Master, we perish. And Jesus wakes up, and what a mess things are in. The storm and all these panic apostles around him. And he arose and he rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. and the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Look at that man standing in that boat that looked out over all this wind and waves and these panicked men around him. He said, "Peace, be still," and it's calm. And all those little boats right there safe. Now let me ask this. Does that look like a man to you? Let me read to you from the Psalm 65, verses 5 through 7. "By terrible things and righteousness wilt thou answer us, O God of our salvation, who art the confidence of all the ends of the earth and of them that are afar off upon the sea, which by his strength setteth fast the mountains, being girded with power, which stilleth the noise of the sea, the noise of their waves, and the tumult of the people." Who does that look like now? Psalm 93, verses 1 through 5. "The Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself. The world is also established that it cannot be moved. Thy throne is established of old. Thou art from everlasting to everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their waves. The Lord on high is mightier than the noise of many waters, yea, than the mighty waves of the sea. Thy testimonies are very sure. Holiness becometh thine house, O Lord, forever." Now, what do you think of that man? And then he rebuked his apostles. He rebuked the sea. What if you had been there and saw him? He rebuked the sea. And then he turns and he rebukes you. "Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith?" He had prayed all night concerning these men and had chosen them. And look how they're acting. They'd heard him. They'd heard him when he preached the Sermon on the Mount. "Take no thought for the morrow. Seek first the kingdom of heaven." They'd seen the miracles that he did. They'd seen him have power over the demons. And yet they're out in the sea. And listen. No water can swallow the ship where lies the master of ocean and earth and skies. Why were they so fearful? "How is it that ye have no faith after all the evidence they had been given?" And they feared exceedingly. And I would add too. If he had rebuked me after rebuking those seas, and he rebuked me, I'd fear too. "They feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Let's go back to the Psalms. This time, Psalm 89, verses 6 through 9. "Who in the heaven can be compared unto the Lord? Who among the sons of the mighty can be likened unto the Lord? God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints, and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him. O Lord God of hosts, who is a strong Lord like unto thee, or to thy faithfulness round about thee? Thou rulest the raging of the sea, when the waves thereof arise, thou stillest them." Who do we have here that can suffer all the infirmities of the flesh and then show such mighty power? Well, that's why Mark is telling us this. He wants us to know. You think his story's true? You think that's true? Well, here's some reasons to believe. We've got three accounts, and Matthew was there. All of those three accounts, one of them is right there. He can talk about what he saw when he was there. Now, Mark, he knew those that were there. He would have known them. And Luke, he'd heard all these stories. He followed Paul into Jerusalem, and while Paul's in prison, Luke checked it out. You know, you read all this, wouldn't it be nice if somebody went down there and checked it out? Well, Luke did. He checked it out. And they tell these stories. Now look at these three accounts. Sometimes just sit down and read them together, and what you're going to find is they're harmonious, but they're independent. They're not copying one another. Mark's the only one tells us about the boats. I think Matthew tells us he rebuked his apostles and then rebuked the sea. Well, he could have rebuked them and rebuked the sea and rebuked them again, but the point is that they're not copying each other. They didn't get their stories together and make sure, okay, let's make sure we all say the same thing so it'll sound like it's true. They didn't say the same things, and yet you put their accounts together and they all harmonize. It's exactly like you would expect if you were interrogating multiple witnesses. And so the stories collaborate. And then there's all those witnesses in the little boats. You don't believe us? We got a crowd of witnesses. Go find some of those that were in the little boats. They'll tell you. And then what we know about boats and storms on the Sea of Galilee exactly match what we read about in this story, except for that sudden calmness that came. The stories line up with what we can verify, and they're self-condemning. Listen, these apostles, they're telling on themselves here. We got in trouble that day. We got rebuked. We had the little faith. They're not telling a story to elevate themselves. They're telling a story about Jesus and then the manner that it is told. You read those accounts. It's not the way men write. They just tell it, it's just the most calm matter of fact, manner of what happened. There's one mind behind the three stories. It's the Holy Spirit of God working through these men, giving us these three accounts. And then you place this in its context with all the surrounding evidence. You think this is true? Oh, ye of little faith, why didst thou doubt? We have the evidence, the rebuke that Jesus gave his apostles is the rebuke we need to consider if we doubt this story, if we doubt this. We've got the evidence. How is it that you have no faith? Now we talk about storms. And this story has helped so many people down through the years. When their life got out of control. When they awoke that morning not knowing what that day would hold and what a disaster is occurring around me. And the tumult of the people and the toils of our life. And we sing about it. Master, with anguish of spirit I bow in my grief today. The depths of my sad heart are troubled. Oh, waken and save, I pray. Torrents of sin and of anguish sweep o'er my sinking soul. And I perish, dear Master. Oh, hasten and take control. There's another song, I don't think it's in our book, but it's a spiritual that is sung. I think I actually heard Tennessee Ernie Ford singing this one on an old record that I used to listen to. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me. In the midst of tribulation, stand by me. When the host of hell assail, and my strength begins to fail, thou who never lost a battle, stand by me. In the midst of faults and failures, haven't we all struggled with our own faults and failures? In the midst of faults and failures, stand by me. When I do the best I can, and my friends don't understand, thou who knowest all about me, stand by me. And then this last verse, when I'm growing old and feeble, stand by me. When my life becomes a burden, and I'm nearing cheerily Jordan, O thou lily of the valley, stand by me. O thou blessed rock of ages, stand by me. Aren't we glad we have this story? I mean, Jesus that can rule over the winds and the waves of that little sea of Galilee, he can rule over the storms that crash in upon our lives. He'll be right there with us through the midst of the storm. What manner of man is this? He's a man that knows our infirmities because he took on the flesh and experienced those infirmities and tells us, you can count on me. I'll be right there with you. You know what that makes me want to do? That makes me want to follow Jesus. That's what I want to do. I want to be baptized into Jesus Christ and live this life with him in my boat so that I can face the storm without fear. Don't you want to do that? If you hadn't been baptized into Christ, you need to do that today. And if you hadn't been faithful to him, oh, little faith, strengthen your faith and trust in him as we go through this life and then into eternity. If you want to respond to this, then come forward as we stand and sing.